What's up, guys? JV2017 here, and this is my full and complete analysis of the confusing yet satisfying finale to one of the greatest franchises in video game history. This is BioShock Infinite Burial at Sea Episode 2 Explained. If you missed Episode 1 Explained, the link to that video is in the description. By the end of this video, I hope I will have answered any and all questions you have about the second part of this DLC. And if I don't, always feel free to leave a question in the comments section below, because someone else will try to answer it, and of course I will try my best to answer it as well. Also, don't hold me accountable for every theory presented in this video. Infinite's themes are quite deep, and many of its concepts are left open to interpretation, so keep that in mind while listening to my theories and while formulating your own. Before we begin with Episode 2, let's quickly recap the events of Burial at Sea Episode 1. Elizabeth arrives in the alternate universe of Rapture to help Booker find Sally the orphan. They find Sally hiding in the vents, and Elizabeth decides to flush her out by making Booker close all of them and turning up the heat. Booker tries to yank Sally out of the vent, which triggers a flashback. It is revealed that Booker has actually been Comstock, only acting like Booker. Instead of baby Anna only losing her pinky in the past, she lost her head in this universe. Comstock hired the Lutesses again to send him to another alternate universe where Anna never existed, which happened to be Rapture. This was so Comstock could forget his guilt for accidentally killing Anna. Elizabeth's purpose is to force Comstock to relive the events and get revenge on him. Okay, so now that we have that out of the way, let's continue on to Burial at Sea Episode 2. Part 2 begins with Elizabeth living out her fantasy in the beautiful streets of Paris. Elizabeth has always wanted to live here, and her dream seems to have finally come true. The mood and the environment take a turn for the worse when Elizabeth comes across Sally, the same orphan Comstock adopted in Rapture from Burial at Sea Part 1. She chases Sally to a door resembling DeWitt Investigations.
Go away. It wasn't my fault. I didn't do anything! No! It wasn't my fault! Leave me alone! Can't you just leave me alone? I'm sorry! I'm sorry! I never should have left. I never should have left you there.
This horrifying scene symbolizes Elizabeth's inaction during the final events of Part 1. At the end, the Big Daddy kills Comstock. He wasn't able to rescue Sally, and neither was Elizabeth. She was so consumed with getting revenge on Comstock that she didn't rescue Sally. This inaction haunts her and abruptly ends her little fantasy in Paris. Continuing on, we find Elizabeth on the floor next to a dead Comstock.
Empty. Empty again. What are the odds?
What's the holdup?
Just having a bit of a laugh, Atlas.
This ain't a sporting event. Put a bullet in her. No need to torture the poor girl. We're not animals, you know.
All right.
Let her go!
Quiet down, dear. In a minute, all your problems will be over.
Elizabeth, tell him you can get him back.
Booker? Booker,
say,
what? I don't understand.
Say... I can get you back to Rapture.
What?
Just say it.
I can get you back to Rapture.
Put the gun down. Now, what was that you said about Rapture?
I can get you back to Rapture.
And how you plan on doing that, sister? You some kind of magician?
Suchong.
What?
Tell him Suchong.
Suchong.
And how do you know that, slant-eyed wonder?
You're his lab assistant.
I'm his lab assistant.
If it escaped your notice, Andrew Ryan sunk us 5,000 fathoms below his shining city. How does Suchong propose to get us back?
That's between me.
That's between me.
And the slant.
And the slant. But if I do this, the girl goes with me.
Little sisters are worth their weight in gold. She's not up for negotiation.
Last time I checked, back in the city they were making little sisters by the dozen.
That's a right fairy tale you've dreamed up, sister. But if you're lying, we can just as well kill you tomorrow. Down here, we got nothing but time. In case I need to get hold of you. If you see Su Chong, tell him Atlas says he hasn't forgotten him.
Elizabeth wakes up in what appears to be the exact same place of the final scenes in Burial at Sea Episode 1. Comstock lies dead on the ground, murdered by the Big Daddy. The scene in Paris seemed to be just a dream that turned into a nightmare. All the while, Atlas from the original Bioshock seems to have found Elizabeth in the aftermath of Part 1. We don't know why Elizabeth was asleep on the floor though. I think we can assume that she was knocked out by one of Atlas's men, for now. One of the henchmen hauls Sally away as Booker seems to appear out of nowhere tuning his guitar. He feeds Elizabeth lines to say to Atlas in order to rescue Sally and her own life. Elizabeth offers Atlas a way back to Rapture via Su Chong the scientist. Remember from the original Bioshock that Atlas is actually Frank Fontaine putting on an accent. Elizabeth gets knocked out and wakes up again.
Elizabeth, come on, it's time to get moving.
Booker? What?
Over here, on the radio.
You're not Booker.
Well, of course I ain't.
What have I gotten myself into? I didn't orphan that girl. I didn't kidnap her.
But she made for some exceptional bait, didn't she?
Had to be done.
Did it?
I felt everything that every version of me felt. All of that knowledge. I lost a pinky. But that version of me, she lost everything. And Comstock, that final Comstock, he thought he could avoid his guilt by coming here.
You educated him proper.
But then why am I back here? Huh? I don't remember opening a tear to come back. And who are you? Huh?
I think you'll figure that out soon enough.
Booker continues to speak to Elizabeth through the ham radio. He highlights the fact that Elizabeth used Sally the orphan to bait Comstock into attracting the attention of a Big Daddy, which resulted in his death. Elizabeth picks up the doll head, which resembles Comstock accidentally severing her head as a baby in an alternate universe, the one he came from to live in Rapture. Her reason for wanting revenge on Comstock was that she could see through all of the doors and feel the pain that he caused. In her eyes, what happened to Sally had to be done so that she could get revenge on Comstock for killing her as a baby in an alternate universe. Elizabeth also reveals that she murdered the final Comstock, which confirms my suspicions presented in my Part 1 Explained video. The whole point of Part 1 was for Elizabeth to get revenge and kill off a Comstock, perhaps even the last Comstock. The reason he is the final Comstock is because of that final scene from Infinite. I'll explain this in detail at the end of the video. Elizabeth also presents some profound questions, such as, why is she there, and who is Booker talking to her on the radio? As she continues on, Booker confirms that the Paris scene was indeed just her imagination. Booker also admits that he is not actually talking to Elizabeth. More on this is explained in the following scene.
What are you? And how did you know exactly what to tell Atlas?
Let me ask you a question. You feeling like yourself, Elizabeth?
I feel strange and smaller. I can't see the doors. What's behind the doors? I can't see the future. I can't even see any tears. Oh my God. Stay away from me. No, no, please, please don't. I died here. I was killed by that. Stay away from me! But then, how am I here? How can I be dead in this world and yet... My finger. What am I? Huh? I don't understand.
So Elizabeth admits that she cannot see through all the doors or open any of the tears. It is then revealed that Elizabeth was actually killed by the Big Daddy that killed Comstock at the end of episode 1. She also begins to bleed from her nose, which we know foreshadows Elizabeth's death. The reason we know this is because Booker had the same condition throughout Infinite, and so did Comstock when he acted like Booker in part 1. Both of these men died, so we can expect Elizabeth to as well. Her pinky is also not deformed, which is strange. The fact that she can see her dead body in this world and is still alive will be explained in the next cutscene.
If we're going to end up in the same place, it's a hard ride.
Are you being cute?
I've come round to your way of thinking.
Have you?
Yes. I do believe one can change things, but after all the bother, one often wishes that one had not.
You're a fatalist.
A physicist.
A fatalist.
So was Newton, especially when it came to apples falling from trees. They always contrive to land with a splat. She left the child to rot.
Are you implying she's the apple?
I'm implying that she did not fall far from the tree.
And now she wants to go back.
I need to go back. To fix what I broke. Back to where she has no right to be.
Back to where she doesn't belong.
Doesn't belong? Wait, what do you mean? Do you want to tell her brother, or shall I? Because I died. There are rules.
Even for one such as you.
She'll forget.
All the doors.
And what's behind all the doors.
All closed to her now.
She'll be just like the rest of us.
Forgetting the past.
The present.
The future.
I'd wager she won't even remember this conversation. We've arrived. You're trading omniscience and croissance for death and mildew.
I left Sally to rot. For what? So I could punish Comstock? He was trying to help her, to save her, and I... If I don't make that right...
We all have our crosses to bear.
But there is a thin line between a martyr...
Lutess has warned me that if I came back here, I would collapse.
Collapse?
From a quantum superposition to just me.
Quantum what?
I've changed, Booker. No tears, no cosmic knowledge. Just a normal girl. With a normal pinky.
This entire scene is riddled with insight into Elizabeth's current state of being. It is my belief that this scene actually occurs chronologically between the end of part 1 and the beginning of part 2. For some reason, Elizabeth needed the help of the Lutesses to bring her back to Rapture so that she could fix her mistakes in part 1. However, Rosalind Lutess explains that one can change things, but often finds that one wishes they hadn't changed anything. I believe this refers to Elizabeth changing the infinite universes of Booker's and Comstock's by drowning Booker at his baptism. And furthermore, that Elizabeth will wish that she had not changed that. Rosalind also compares Elizabeth to Comstock by saying that the apple didn't fall far from the tree when she left Sally to die, just as Comstock accidentally killed Anna in an alternate universe. Elizabeth's intentions in going back to Rapture were to fix her mistake of leaving Sally to die, but the Lutesses explain that there are rules, even for one that can travel through tears. Once one travels back to the universe where one died, one loses the ability to see through all of the doors, to travel through tears to alternate universes, and to remember the past, present, and future. When Elizabeth went through the door of that lighthouse, she accepted the fact that she would collapse into a quantum superposition. This phenomenon results in Elizabeth returning to Rapture as a normal girl with a normal pinky, forced to solve her mistakes without her tear powers.
If I can't open tears, I'm never leaving here, am I? I'm never going back to Paris. You're just what? You're just the fragments of my memory telling me what my future holds?
You decided to come here, Elizabeth. You knew what that meant. Only option, as I see it, is to trust yourself. Find Su Chong.
Elizabeth realizes that her decision to fix her mistakes also means that she can never leave Rapture or go to Paris. As Booker slash Comstock explained in part 1, everyone in Rapture is buried at sea, forced to live there in perpetuity. Elizabeth also reveals that Booker is not actually talking to her on the radio because he's not actually alive anymore. She drowned Booker and killed off the last Comstock, so there's no way he could actually be talking to her. He's just a projection of Elizabeth's own imagination to help her along in her journey to fix her mistakes. When he randomly appears in that Atlas scene, she was just imagining the idea of him being there, telling her what to say. While this part isn't relevant to the explanation, Elizabeth travels through Andrew Ryan's prep academy for children on her way to find Su Chong. Ryan's brainwashing video of Ryan the Lion and Peter the Parasite is a pretty awesome nod to the original Bioshock. Further ahead, Elizabeth reflects on her current state.
Once I could see everything, every possible moment. And now...
You're just like everyone else.
Why? Why, because I died here? If I'm just like everyone else, I can't help Sally. I can't even get back to where I was.
If you don't mind me asking, love, why are you talking to nobody? If I had pegged you for a loon, I might have had second thoughts on our arrangement.
I'll hold up my end, but I better find the girl the way I left her.
You're in no position to make demands. But I must confess, I do like a bit of sass in a lass.
Elizabeth realizes that she can't help Sally by changing the past like she could when she had her tear powers. However, in her normal form, she can still make a difference. In Su Chong's lab, Elizabeth learns an interesting fact about the scientist.
Columbia? He knew about Columbia. And Booker and me. The Su Chong must have found a way to reopen the tear I made to come here. But how?
Su Chong knows about the events of Columbia and somehow reopened the tear that Elizabeth used to come to Rapture in part 1. This explains why Su Chong shut down the Silverfin restaurant and claimed it as his lab.
A Lutece device? That's how he must have reopened the tear. Look, the tear still leads back to Columbia. Plasmids, Vigors. He and Fink must have been in communication, sharing secrets. Like the Lutesses before they were physically together. Why did I need to come here? What does this have to do with Sally?
You remember, don't you?
It hasn't happened yet? I told you, I can't do that.
Concentrate, Elizabeth.
No, the doors are shut. They're... Lutece particle. I use the Lutece particle. If it can make a city float...
It can make a prison rise.
I can't open tears, but we could use this device to go to Columbia and find a particle. But it's been vandalized.
You'll fix it.
Sure. You know, my tower didn't come stock with the Lutece device repair manual.
You will fix it.
Yeah, I'll just...
Elizabeth, you will fix it.
Okay. Okay, there must be some information around here.
Su Chong shut down the restaurant so that he could reopen the tear back to Columbia, where Elizabeth came from in part 1. Elizabeth points out the striking similarity between plasmids and Vigors, concluding that Su Chong and Fink must have been collaborating and sharing their ideas. Booker then persuades Elizabeth to remember how she lifted Fontaine Station back up to Rapture. The answer lies in Columbia in the form of the Lutece particle, which is what allows Columbia to float in the sky. Elizabeth first has to fix the device. While searching Su Chong's lab, she comes across the Lutece device's documentation.
These are elements. Sodium, titanium. Why would these be on schematics for... It's code. A visionaire cipher. If we assume hydrogen is A, And iron the 26th element is C.
You always used to need a code key. Or...
it's right here. Never underestimate the fallibility of the egomaniac. Looks like a punch list for things Su Chong needs to fix the machine. A cold cathode tube, a carbon dioxide scrubber, and a heatsink.
Any of the vending machines should have the cathode tube.
And we can look for a CO2 scrubber in the bathysphere showroom. A lot of models should have them.
A heatsink. Oh, that's... where in a department store are we gonna find...
keep your cool with old man Winter.
That'll work.
Elizabeth deciphers Su Chong's complex code that he uses to hide his notes, revealing the parts she needs to repair the Lutece device. This code will be important as we continue on. In yet another elevator, Elizabeth looks to imaginary Booker for guidance.
You okay?
I've seen all this happen before. I've seen everything that will happen, and now... now... I only see darkness.
You sent yourself here for a reason.
A debt.
That's what you want to call it.
This Atlas. I'm gonna have to kill him. Either that or he'll kill me.
Maybe so.
I'm not you, Booker. Some war hero. I'm not even me anymore. No tears, no omniscience, or whatever you want to call it. Just a whole lot of book learning. And a handful of lockpicks.
She explains again how she returned to Rapture to settle a debt, which happens to be her neglect of Sally in part one. Elizabeth also identifies her fate that she will ultimately have to face, either kill Atlas or be killed by Atlas. While searching for the parts, Elizabeth discovers a decrypted message.
Looks like someone's been decrypting a code. We've confirmed completion of the ace in the hole. Su Chong has it, but unlikely to give it up easily. We'll update when we know more. What's that all about?
This is a subtle clue to what we'll be dealing with at the end of the video. Elizabeth can find three more messages around Rapture, but I neglected to find them myself. Elizabeth returns to repair the Lutece device, travels through the tear to Columbia, and grabs the Lutece particle.
Pretty lady not finished yet.
What? Open the tear.
Power for device, very expensive. Need for that?
Just tell me what you want.
Su Chong wanted something simple. Lock of hair.
Oh, you're not serious.
Not your hair, stupid. Fink has a secret lab. Mothballed, forgotten. In there, hair sample. In jar. Cannot miss it. You get for Su Chong, then everybody friends.
Where is his lab?
Closed off, past Fink's quarters, and you smart lady, you find it.
Populi, you must have arrived right in the middle of the siege.
That means the other you and I are probably inside the factory, on our way up to the First Lady.
And what happens if we run into ourselves?
We won't.
How do you know that?
Because we didn't.
Instead of making things easy for everyone, Su Chong forces Elizabeth to retrieve a lock of hair from Fink's lab in Columbia. This task appears like more busy work for Elizabeth, but really serves to reveal a ton of valuable information. She also points out some awesome multiverse logic when Booker questions whether Elizabeth will run into the alternate Booker and Elizabeth. Obviously she won't, because the alternate Booker and Elizabeth didn't run into Elizabeth in the original Columbia universe. Fascinating stuff. In the office of Jeremiah Fink, more pieces of the Columbia story come together.
I've taken your counsel, and you done me good service, but I will not hurt the boy. I will see Fink and Comstock burn, but I will not hold the son to account for the deeds of his father.
You've misunderstood us.
We neither asked you to harm the child.
Nor did we promise that yours would be the hand that would set Comstock's world afire.
A famous man once said...
and a famous man shall say...
I may reach the mountaintop...
but I fear I shall never visit the valley below.
But you mean I won't live to see the... no.
It's up to you what matters more.
Your part in the play.
Or the play itself.
Someone is coming.
She'll arrive, a girl.
She must leave, a woman.
And what makes the difference between a girl and a woman?
Blood.
your part in the play.
Or the play itself.
Turn her into a killer? How?
Give the girl no choice.
And she will be forced to make one.
This scene shows how the Lutesses helped Daisy along with their scheme to take down Comstock and influence Elizabeth's actions in Columbia. In Fink's living quarters, a voxophone uncovers more information.
Our current state of being, or lack thereof, has left my brother unfulfilled. The biological urge to leave one's mark is strong. And it is not an impossibility. We could instantiate ourselves back in Columbia. Return to an old life for the possibility of creating new. But we died in that world. Returning would mean giving up part of us. Ourselves. We'd become flesh and all that it is heir to. The mysteries of the universe would become once again mysteries.
Rosalind Lutess's recording gives us more insight into the quantum superposition that Elizabeth is experiencing. The Lutesses also wanted to return to the Columbia universe to make a mark on the world, but because Comstock killed them in Columbia, that would mean that they would become mere mortals, unable to travel between tears. Fink's leisure quarters contains a voxophone with even more information.
Sea slugs. Goddamn sea slugs. Could that Oriental have come up with a more inconvenient fuel for his plasmids? If there is a god, and I've seen more evidence to the contrary than in support, you'd think he'd have put Adam into the belly of a nice little seagull or crow. The cost of all these underwater expeditions are murdering my margins.
Here we find evidence of the collaboration between Suchong's plasmids and Fink's vigors. Suchong discovered that sea slugs carry Adam, the genetic material that make plasmids possible. Through the tear Elizabeth opened, Suchong shared his findings with Fink and made him realize that his vigors were far less efficient and required Fink to harvest 10 times more Adam. This information is only one of many fascinating revelations the two men shared with each other. As Elizabeth descends into an elevator, she passes by Booker and Elizabeth from the Events of Infinite. Once inside Fink's lab, Elizabeth discovers more Fink-Suchong collaborations.
Seems like Fink and Suchong were sharing their research.
Like the Lutesses. Cross-reality collaboration. It all makes a kind of sense. The little sisters and the big daddies. Songbird and me.
Constants and variables.
The case that I walked past displayed Fink's attempts to recreate the Big Daddy in Columbia and more evidence to support his collaboration with Suchong. The Big Daddy recording also explains the connection of the relation between Big Daddies and Little Sisters and Songbird and Elizabeth. The constant is that something large and dominant protects something that is small and valuable. The variables are the differences between Big Daddy and Songbird and Little Sister and Elizabeth. Further in Fink's lab, Elizabeth discovers more of Fink's methods.
What is all this?
Imprinting. That's a wire mother. If you separate a gorilla from its real mother, it will imprint on almost anything. Even that.
Why would Fink care about that?
Songbird. He wanted him to imprint on me.
Well, if I recall, that was a problem he solved.
Fink's testing exposes one of his many theories on how to make Songbird emotionally attached and protective of Elizabeth. The power of imprinting. Since Elizabeth's tear powers are so valuable an asset, it makes sense that Comstock was the one that put Fink up to the task of finding a way to create a guardian to protect her. Just as Ryan recruited Suchong to invent a way to protect little sisters in the form of Big Daddies. All around Fink's lab lay the remnants of his failed imprinting experiments. None of them seemed to work, yet Songbird obviously imprinted on Elizabeth eventually. The mystery is solved once Elizabeth finds this projector.
little girl in the film. It's me. My God. I remember. He'd crashed into the tower. I guess he was in some sort of fight. I waited there thinking, I don't know, that something would happen, but he just lay there, moaning. I couldn't just...
The line with the thorn in its paw. So much for science.
I should have just left him there to die. I should have just... I will never escape it. Exploited, exploiting. Me, Comstock, you, Sally. It's like a wheel of blood spinning round and round.
Not only does she discover how Elizabeth imprinted onto her, she exposes a larger truth. This entire story of Infinite and Burial at Sea is one of exploitation. Elizabeth, Booker, and Sally the Orphan were all exploited by alternate universe versions of Comstock. To make a long story short, Comstock is one bad motor scooter. Elizabeth recovers the hair sample.
Well, this must be the genetic sample Su Chong wanted.
He sent you all the way back here for a sample of your own hair.
He doesn't know I was once the child that imprinted on Songbird. But to him, all the answers lie in DNA. Men like Su Chong mistake an ounce of empathy for a pound of science.
This explains why Elizabeth even needed to return to Columbia in the first place instead of just giving him a lock of her own hair. Su Chong is blissfully unaware that Elizabeth is the child that imprinted on Songbird, but she played her cards right for her benefit. It's probably better that Su Chong doesn't know this fact. On the way back to the Tear, a voxophone recorded by Fink explains that his discovery of imprinting caused him to cut all ties with Su Chong. Keep this information in mind as we continue on. Further on, Elizabeth reflects on her current situation.
Do you think Daisy really even had a choice?
What do you mean?
Right about now, I'm planting a pair of scissors in her back to protect a child she was never going to harm. She chose to die for her revolution. What about me? For all the endless worlds, all the infinite possibilities, did I ever even have a choice? Did you?
Yeah. Booker thought he did.
Look where it got us. Right back where we started.
This beautiful piece of dialogue represents the paradoxical nature of the entire game. Even with the infinite possibilities, did Elizabeth or Booker ever have a choice in anything? Did their actions impact the world of infinite loops and possibilities? Did they really affect the world in any way? Or were their efforts to make a change an attempt to make a difference predetermined in the first place? It raises deeper points of predestination and the idea that everything is planned, but we won't delve into that confusing mess in this video. Nonetheless, this presents the thought-provoking revelation that BioShock Infinite is in fact infinite and finite at the same time.
All these infinite universes. And yet we end up just going down the same paths.
No, don't take your meaning.
My father sold me to settle a market. Comstock locked me up in a tower. And I sold Sally for what? Revenge? To prove a point?
And yet, here you are. Settling the debt.
And say we find her. The old past their damage to the young. Isn't it too late for her now?
Well, I'd say that's up to her to decide. Justice coming back here was up to you.
Rapture runs on children. Little girls with gold growing in their bellies. I'm not gonna break any cycle. If I'm lucky, maybe I can dent it. Just a little.
Here, Elizabeth reaffirms what the Lutesses brought up earlier. The apple doesn't fall far from the tree when it comes to Booker, Comstock, and Elizabeth. From generation to generation, across universe to universe, each of these characters committed some form of injustice. But imaginary Booker reminds her that she is attempting to settle the debt, no matter how insignificant her efforts may prove in the end. The same could be said for Booker's time in Columbia and his quest to settle a debt. Even if Elizabeth can't save Sally herself, Sally can make the same choice that Elizabeth made in coming back to Rapture. Sally can decide to settle her debts or avoid them like Comstock. While I don't believe that Booker actually means that Sally the Orphan will do this, it still proves a powerful point about the settling of debts concept. Elizabeth returns to Rapture and delivers the hair sample to Soochong, but Andrew Ryan stops them in their tracks. Ryan forces Elizabeth to choose between him and Atlas, and is not pleased with her decision.
Todd, you're not a hero. You're not even a parasite. You're just a room. And Andrew Ryan has no time for rooms.
After Elizabeth defeats Ryan's henchmen, Elizabeth shares her plan with Atlas.
What's your plan?
I can't just place the particle on the ceiling. It would just tear right through it. But every building in Rapture was submerged into the ocean on a lunette ring, connected to the junction of its load-bearing supports.
That's fascinating and all, but if you haven't noticed, Ryan sent his goons to murder us. If you're gonna pull a rabbit out of a hat, now's the time to do it.
Looks like the structural junction is in Frank Fontaine's office. If I can get there, I can float the building.
It so happens I've taken that bastard's office for my own use. I'll make sure you've access to the private elevator. Now hurry.
Elizabeth plans to place the Lutece particle where all of the load-bearing supports meet. This is in Frank Fontaine's office. Now, since we have prior knowledge of playing through the original Bioshock, we know that Atlas is lying through his teeth when he says he stole the office from Fontaine. Atlas is Fontaine. However, we need to remember that Elizabeth has no knowledge of this whatsoever.
Elizabeth, you know Atlas is going to...
I know. And I'm ready.
Are you sure?
I sent myself here for a reason. Didn't I?
And who exactly are you speaking to, Miss Comstock? If I were less acquainted with the vicissitudes of genius, I suspect I would question your sanity. I know so little of you, but I imagine the more I learned, the more exceptional I would find you. You know Atlas will betray you.
And what are you, my best friend?
You're one of a kind in this world, or others. And now, your misguided sense of altruism sends you to your doom. It's like watching Isaac Newton die in a house fire. In a vain attempt to save his cat.
Booker and Ryan warn Elizabeth that Atlas will betray her, yet she carries on with this burden. She knows what will happen, but she has to settle a debt. Even if it does mean that she winds up the same way Booker did at the end of Infinite. Elizabeth enters Fontaine's office and places the Lutece particle on the load-bearing position, fulfilling her promise to Atlas.
Oh, great.
Did your mom ever teach you not to put your faith in strange foreign
men? Just give me the girl. She means nothing to you.
You've got that right. The girl means nothing. But you, love, you mean the world.
As expected, Atlas does not fulfill his promise to Elizabeth. Instead, he gets one of his henchmen to chloroform her. Pretty rapey, if you ask me.
No cause for alarm. She's well sedated. So, it's begun.
The Kashmir's all blown to hell. If Ryan didn't know we were back before, I'm sure now he's got the message.
What do you want with this?
If anybody's got the line on the ace, it's her. Find out what she knows. But no quackery. She's no good to us with a halo and a set of wings.
I get started as soon as the chloroform wears off. Don't see her as too tough a nut.
Other than the fact that Atlas is describing the beginning events of the 1958 New Year's Eve riots in Rapture, the main thing to take away here is the ace in the hole line. Remember that subtle clue I mentioned earlier that Elizabeth found on the decrypted message? According to Atlas, Elizabeth is the only one that could possibly have a line on the Ace. After more torture, Elizabeth experiences a vision in her drug-induced slumber and awakes 2 weeks later.
This world values children, not childhood. There's a profit to be made, and men who make it.
Folks say it's only a matter of time until Atlas' entire mob comes out waving the white flag.
Two weeks.
What?
You've been down 2 weeks, Love. Feckin' doctors. Better off hiring a million monkeys.
Our deal was to get you out of prison. What, did you expect me to win your war for you too?
I'd tend to your own knitting if I were you. Now, darling. Being that you were Su Chong's lab assistant and all, why not tell me where me ace in the hole went to?
I don't know.
As I said, I'm no doctor. But that doesn't mean I don't find the field fascinating. I keep up on all the medical journals and the like.
I hope you have someone to help you with all the big words.
You know what part of the brain free will comes from? Stubbornness? The prefrontal lobe. Now, I think it's fair to say, you're a bit of a stubborn one, are you not? A man named Steinman taught me this. He's a bit of a lunatic, but a fine surgeon. He calls this little trick a transorbital lobotomy. Take hold of her, lads.
You're wasting your time.
If you won't remain still, I can't be held responsible for what comes next. Here we go. You feel that? I'm moving the pick across your eyeball, still now, and resting it on your skull. There's about a bit over a quarter of an inch of bone between the pick and your prefrontal lobe. And that's where this little fella comes in.
I don't...
Shh. It was just a wee tap. But I don't expect it'll take more than a few of those to reach the meat. And then we might find you a bit less the mule. Where's me ace in the hole?
I don't know.
You know what else rests in the lobe? Creativity. Individuality. Personality. In short, what makes you, you. Just about through now. Last chance, pet. Where is the ace in the hole?
Or what? What, you'll put a hole in my head and take away my memories? You want to make me forget all this? You want to make me not care anymore? Go ahead. You'll be doing me a favor.
Oh! Bring in the monster! You're a regular hero, ain't you? Can't risk ripping the only part of you that's worth a damn. Well, there's more than one way to fry an egg. Now, little one, are you familiar with the term transorbital lobotomy?
Please let her go!
It's a simple matter. All I need to do is insert this pick into your eye.
Please, I don't know anything!
A few taps with me.
I don't know anything!
To show by example.
Please! Please don't! I don't know anything! I don't know! Please!
There's not much to explain about the creepy vision Elizabeth experiences until the very end of the game. After she awakens, Atlas believes that Elizabeth would know where the ace in the hole is, because she claimed to be Su Chong's lab assistant at the beginning of the game. Even a transorbital lobotomy does not crack Elizabeth, even though there's nothing to crack. She honestly doesn't know where the ace in the hole is at this point. When Atlas wheels Sally out to perform another transorbital lobotomy, Elizabeth finally cracks.
Shh, it's okay. It's okay. Listen, it's okay.
I can't. tell him what I don't know. Where are we?
You saw all the doors. And what's behind all the doors?
The ace in the hole. It's here.
Yes.
But I don't remember this place.
You've never been here.
Then how would it...
The memories you lost, they weren't just of the past. You saw behind all the doors.
Even the ones into the future. This is where I'm going.
If you want.
I don't like it here.
It's a bad place.
He's never gonna let me go, is he? Even if I bring him the ace. Then why am I here? How, if I was so smart, if I saw so much, why just send myself to the slaughter?
For Sally.
No, one day he will just rip her open and tear out her atom. All of this for nothing. Why did I do it? Why?
You have to decide.
Decide what?
To take a leap of faith. I can't tell you what you were thinking because you don't remember. But you chose to come. There. In that room.
The ace. I don't know what to do, Booker. Booker? Booker! No, please. Please just don't leave me here! Booker!
The threat of Sally's death seems to have sent Elizabeth into an imaginary memory of the future. This sounds insane, but trust me, it makes sense. Imaginary Booker explains that when Elizabeth chose to go back to the place where she died and face the quantum superposition, she did lose the ability to see behind all the doors and universes, past, present, and future. But she did not exactly lose her memories of those doors. And the reason she didn't know initially is because she tried to remember her memories from the past, when she should have been remembering the ones from the future. This gives us insight into why Elizabeth thinks she sent herself to the slaughter for nothing. Imaginary Booker explains that Elizabeth chose to come back to Rapture to save Sally and settle that debt, and that she must see that decision through to the end, to take a leap of faith.
Chong's clinic! It's at Su Chong's clinic.
That's a bit convenient now. Ryan's got every turret in the place tuned to me and me man's genetic code. We'd be torn to shreds before we got 10 feet.
That's right. Which is why I'm gonna do it for you. You okay with that?
Get me the ace. I'll wrap the brat in a silk ribbon. Bag her and bring her to my bathysphere.
In that instant, Elizabeth accessed her memories and found the ace. Pretty incredible stuff. She offers to bring the ace to Atlas in exchange for Sally's life. Once out of the bathysphere, Elizabeth explores Su Chong's clinic and comes across an injured Big Daddy.
Hurt anyone.
Scary.
Shh. Can you move? Can you just move a little bit for me? Don't. I don't know how to help you. I don't.
Scary.
No, he's just hurt. He just needs somebody to figure out how to fix him. Maybe there's some, I don't know, is there some documentation for him around here or something? Right. Look who I'm asking.
Elizabeth discovers one of Su Chong's notes.
Huh. Encoded. Big Daddy will not imprint. If not imprint, what good is he to little sister?
She no like him. He no like her. Situation is impasse. Unacceptable.
Su Chong seemed to have encountered very similar obstacles when trying to imprint the Big Daddies onto the Little Sisters that Fink did with Songbird.
If stupid beasts had half brain, they would realize they need Little Sister to live. Sisters secrete only kind of atom that is genetic match for them. No Little Sister, no Big Daddy.
This somewhat symbiotic relationship between Big Daddies and Little Sisters reminds Elizabeth of Fink's method of imprinting.
Scary, 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 scary!
I've got to do something.
Big Monster Sick.
It's okay, it's okay, please. I don't know how to help him. He needs Adam. I don't have any of that. I don't know what to do.
Going to die. Not fair.
We can help.
Elizabeth effectively used Fink's method of imprinting to revive the Big Daddy.
Clinical trial. Protector system. Plasma below 255. Dr. Fincom. Client, Ryan Industries. Many frustrating day. I can't seem to get the damn Big Daddies to imprint on the little brat. The protection bondage is just another for me. Get away. Maybe if I modify the genetic sequence to... sequence to allow for...
Papa Su Chong.
Get away, you filthy little shit! What? What are you doing?
Although we only saw the aftermath of Su Chong's death and listened to an audio diary in the original Bioshock, we never actually witnessed the event until now. Su Chong complains that he can't get the Big Daddies to imprint on the Little Sisters, then abruptly gets murdered by a Big Daddy for striking a Little Sister. This event, along with the previous scene, proves that Elizabeth was actually responsible for Big Daddy's imprinting onto Little Sisters. Not Su Chong. Remember when I mentioned earlier in the video that Fink cut all ties with Su Chong after Fink discovered the imprinting technique? Fink did not want to share this secret with Su Chong. The entire reason for Big Daddy's imprinting onto Little Sisters was due to the fact that Elizabeth traveled to Rapture after Infinite to kill Comstock, then traveled back to Rapture to save Sally, then ended up traveling back to Columbia to discover how Fink imprinted Songbird onto herself, only to return again to Rapture and implement the technique on a Big Daddy. It is absolutely mind-blowing to think that Elizabeth is the sole reason that the world of the original Bioshock was affected in such a way that Big Daddies patrol around and protect Little Sisters. Brilliant.
There's the ace. This is the ace in the hole. All the pain and all of the death for this.
Before the lights dim on the note with Su Chong's code, the top portion reads, Fontaine's ace in the hole, and the bottom paper-clipped picture is of none other than Jack from the original Bioshock. You may already be sensing the connection here, but I'd rather have the game explain it first.
Hey, sister. Over here. Do you have it?
I have it.
Give it over, then. I'm keen to get this brat off me hands.
You know what? Andrew Ryan said I was a rube. But he was wrong. I'm not the rube, Atlas. You are. Now, we both know what happens next. Just get it over with.
Well, love, if you insist. This? It's just a bunch of gibberish.
What does this say, you little whore?
Hey!
What does this say?
You kindly.
We've got the activation phrase. Now all we've got to do is get that genetic freak of nature on an airplane and Rapture's heirs. Yeah!
Save the world entire. It is you who are their savior.
I can see all the doors. And what's behind all the doors. And behind one of them, incredibly, I see him.
Et ça me fait quelque chose, ça.
Il est entré dans mon cœur une part de bonheur dont je connais la cause.
Okay. Not only does Elizabeth finally settle her debt, this ending ties the entirety of the original Bioshock to Bioshock Infinite, and it is masterfully well done. Let's go through it step by step. Elizabeth returns to Fontaine with the ace in the hole, and he does what he was going to do all along. We are transported back to that creepy vision in the mirror that Elizabeth experienced earlier. This time, it is revealed that she is actually on an airplane, the very same airplane that Jack from the original Bioshock took down to start the events of that game. Elizabeth is awakened on and off by Fontaine, since he can't read Suchong's ciphered code. We see Jack get up and hijack the plane himself, and Elizabeth reads the note fluttering by. Now before we go further on, was Elizabeth actually ever on that plane? My bet is that we're dealing with the same kind of scenario when Atlas was about to kill Sally the Orphan. Since Elizabeth used to see through all the doors, even in the future, I think we can assume that she was drawing from memories of the future, like she did when she remembered Suchong's clinic. The single event of Elizabeth giving Fontaine the activation phrase set forth all of the events of the original Bioshock, which is insane. Elizabeth's will to persevere and settle her debt by saving Sally is the sole reason that Fontaine ever got his hands on the activation phrase. She is the reason that Fontaine's uprising over Ryan even took place and was successful. She is the reason Jack hijacked his own plane over the lighthouse entrance to Rapture. She is the reason Big Daddies protect little sisters. She is the reason Jack murders Andrew Ryan. She is the reason Jack defeats Fontaine and the little sisters kill him. She is the reason Jack saves all of the little sisters in at least one alternate universe. And one of those little sisters happens to be Sally. All of these events in Rapture, none of them would have happened had Elizabeth not come back to settle her debt. Andrew Ryan might have still been in power. The genetic freak Jack might have never gone to Rapture. The what if list goes on and on. What matters here is that Elizabeth ultimately settles her debt and saves Sally the Orphan through Jack saving little sisters in one alternate universe. If it was Elizabeth's goal to put a dent in the never-ending cycle that is the Bioshock universe, she sure as hell achieves that goal. Now that we have an entirely different perspective on the universe, let's go through the events of the original Bioshock, Bioshock Infinite, and Burial at Sea in chronological order as they happen. In order to keep this as little confusing as possible, I'm going to focus on what the player experiences and stay away from alternate universe possibilities. First, Booker refuses the baptism after Wounded Knee and remains himself. Years later, he has his baby daughter Anna and ends up giving her away to settle a debt. He happens to give her away to an alternate universe version of himself, Comstock, and Anna's pinky gets lopped off. This gives the baby powers to open tears across universes. Comstock raises this girl as his own daughter, Elizabeth. Then the events of Bioshock Infinite begin. The Lutesses bring Booker to Columbia, where he fights to get Elizabeth back. Booker kills Comstock, and just as Songbird is about to kill him, Elizabeth opens a tear to Rapture. This is where she explains the infinite universes to Booker, and then drowns him at his baptism so that he can't accept the baptism and be reborn as Comstock. The Elizabeths all disappear except for the one that experienced all of the events with the player in Infinite. This Elizabeth survives after the black screen. This is the same baby Anna that Booker has after the credits of Infinite. Please note that this Elizabeth that lost a pinky is the same one we interact with in Infinite and play as in Rapture. She is the same one all along, so try to not get confused. Since we did see Booker at peace with his baby Anna after the credits of Infinite, we know that one Booker exists and one Anna exists, which means another Comstock must exist. Since the one surviving, pinkyless Elizabeth knows this to be fact, she looks through her tears and finds the alternate universe where Comstock still lives. Also note that this means we are dealing with the last Elizabeth as well. Elizabeth initially travels to alternate universe Columbia and finds the last Comstock trying to steal baby Anna from Booker. She tries to stop him, but he accidentally kills Anna in the process. The last Comstock never steals Anna because he kills her, and so he rehires the Lutesses to send him to alternate universe Rapture, where he can begin to forget his guilt. He lives there for over 10 years pretending to be Booker DeWitt and adopting Sally the Orphan. Elizabeth sees this through a tear and decides to go to the alternate universe Rapture to seek revenge. This is where the events of Burial at Sea Episode 1 unfold. Elizabeth uses Comstock's relationship with Sally to force Comstock to relive the events of killing baby Anna. Then the final Comstock is killed by a Big Daddy. Note that this means there are literally no more Comstocks in any universe. All of them were drowned earlier at the end of Infinite. After Part 1 ends, Elizabeth ends up being killed by the Big Daddy as well. Remember that she was also the last Elizabeth. Seriously, there are no more. But since she has her tear powers, she is able to return to another alternate universe, like the Lutesses. Instead of being at peace with killing the last Comstock, Elizabeth feels guilty for not saving Sally the Orphan. She hires the Lutesses to bring her back to Rapture where she can settle the debt of saving Sally. The Lutesses explain that she will lose all of her tear powers and universe omniscience in the process, but Elizabeth accepts this fact. This is where Burial at Sea Episode 2 begins. Elizabeth awakens on the floor with Atlas interrogating her and stealing Sally. She discovers that the quantum superposition did indeed happen, meaning that she lost her powers and has a normal pinky. She is just a mere mortal at this point, and also the final Elizabeth in any universe. By the end of her quest to save Sally, Elizabeth imprints a Big Daddy and delivers the activation phrase to Fontaine. The last Elizabeth dies at the end, which means no more Elizabeths. However, her act of delivering the activation phrase to Fontaine sets forth all of the events of the original Bioshock. This is where the original Bioshock begins. Fontaine uses that activation phrase to bring Jack to Rapture. The events of the original game occur, leaving Fontaine and Ryan dead. And at least in one alternate universe, Jack saves the Little Sisters and rescues Sally. This means that Elizabeth finally settles her debt. Now is the story finally over and is the infinite loop finally now closed? The answer is sort of complicated. One theory is that Elizabeth ended the loop once and for all when she drowned Booker. That event may have caused only one set of alternate universes to exist. The ones where Comstock kills Anna, escapes to Rapture, and Elizabeth kills Comstock. Then the events of the original Bioshock occur. Perhaps Elizabeth's death and handing the activation phrase to Fontaine created a new constant that allowed for another set of infinite universes branching off of that event. We can't really say for sure. Although we do know that at the moment, Ken Levine and his original Irrational Games team will not be working on another Bioshock. The license now belongs to the publisher of the Bioshock series, 2K Games. Now, I don't want to get anyone's hopes down anymore, but I don't believe Bioshock will return to its former glory without the original team and Ken Levine at the helm. There may be more Bioshock games, but they probably won't have the same complexity that the original Bioshock and Bioshock Infinite have. But I do know that their work will inspire many complex games in the future in many alternate universes. Alright guys, I provided the best explanation that I could for Part 2, but I know I'm not 100% correct because these games are meant to be left open to interpretation. If you think I left something out, or are confused, or just have another question, feel free to leave it in the comment section below. Hope you guys enjoyed, and I will talk to you later. Peace!